Just to remind you, we are in the other part of the world, and it's a pleasure for me to be here to give you a short introduction. I have to apologize for the agenda. We have some provocative teases there. We can discuss this later, but it shows a little bit our idea that we are going to discuss not the smart city strategy, but the digital strategy, as we discussed very long time, very intensive about our ideas, how to get a smarter, intelligent city, and what does it mean for our use of technologies or other solutions concerning resilience or other tasks we have as a city. One key of our activities is our ability to act. And if you see the structure of Germany, so we have a number of federal states, like everywhere in the world, we have federal states, and Hamburg is a federal state and a city in one, meaning we have the competences of a state and are responsible for life and work and business in the city. We have the legislative competence, meaning we have also the responsibility to do things by ourselves and not to ask the state to do things for us when we are not able to complain to the state, to the federal government, that's fine enough. But if we are dealing with regional laws, so we have to do that and we have to solve the questions. That brings us in a situation that on the one hand we have the ability, yes, legal-wise, and on the other hand, we have the duty to fulfill this, and we cannot, well, not ask our superior administrative level to work. So that makes us a kind of a test bed or laboratory. And coming to this picture, which is a symptom, it's directly at the edge south banks of the city of Hamburg, directly looking to the port, and I've chosen this because it's a bonfire. The bonfire is not a digital fire, it's an analog, and it's very, very common. A lot of people like to be there, to have a bonfire, and we are not, as a city or a region, we are not willing to substitute the bonfire by the digital fire or LEDs. So it's an analog thing, and human beings in our cities are most analog elements. So I love my children analog way and not digital. And so the question is, should we substitute this analog life by digital life, or should we use digitalization as a mean to make life, analog life, more comfortable? And I can tell you in most of the discussion we come to the result that we should, the last option, make life more comfortable by technology. Is it analog, is it digital, whatever, it's just technology. And if it's artificial intelligence, or is it human intelligence, or is it human stupidity, it's a question we should use it and make use of it in the best way. Of course, we're using technologies. Progress is there in the world, and I will highlight some short elements where and how we organize this and we structure this. And with this digital strategy, not the smart city strategy, of course we made in 2015, after long discussion, intensive discussion with our government, which is the Senate, we developed this digital strategy as a guideline, which is for all ministries, for all offices, the guideline to act in the future and to keep in mind that we have to follow this but also be proactive there. And the staffing, the manning of this office, now we have 70 heads working there with the chief digital officer and responsibility in all ministries and offices being there, schools, citizens, university, everybody has the task to digitalize that. And also to have some inputs in the street in the city. And as we are good public servants, we transfer this crazy picture up here in a structure, columns, and to be operation. So we see ITS and e-culture. Culture is also digital. Our museums are there, our schools are there. We have partial strategies quite on the left in each sector of the administration and also in the policy sector. And we have digital domains, of course, digital domains, our data platform, we come later to that, they cover everything, and we try to have one solution which enables us to answer also questions which are beside the silos. But in fact, we are working on pilots. We did not start with a huge master plan to finish in 30 years, knowing that the progress will be faster than we in our realization. So we started in pilots, where we have specific problems, specific tasks, like on the top left, the university. They start with online studies and with flexibility, not being present in the university. This is just technology-driven. transport systems, whatever means intelligent, maybe advanced transport systems, which enables traffic to flow faster. We have a port number 10 or 12 in the world with container transport. And it's just a challenge every day to bring this container smooth out of the city instead of having traffic congestion, jams, and so on. Of course, we need urban data. We have e-culture. What does it mean? What does it mean indeed? Can you see everything which is in the museum, in the stocks, anywhere in the underground? Can you see it online now? But in what resolution can you make a cultural research? Can you visit Mona Lisa in the future with X-ray screened on your computer? Or what does it really mean? And what is the demand of all people as a customer? And if you ask myself, I'm always happy to go into the Louvre live and not on my computer at home. That's another experience. But I appreciate that I have the chance to get all information. So we do not substitute one by the other, but we try to extend our possibilities by use of technologies. One good example where it's always visible in the street is traffic mobility. We heard a lot of this today. And what normal situation, traffic congestion, so my mayor will not be very happy about that. But we have, of course, traffic congestion. Each city has traffic congestion, if it's not anywhere in the northern polar circle. But the solutions to solve congestions are several. One solution we tried, and it was strange yesterday evening when I walked to Melbourne, some shops closed at 7 o'clock. If you open the shops until 10 o'clock in the evening, you do not have this rush hour, half an hour before 7. So we can range the ability of people to buy. Or another congestion fighting need was to have a flexibility in the commuter transportation. So the simple calculation was, if you want to reduce a commuter amount about 20%, or traffic flow going fast about 20%, so we can widen our roads for 20%, or 20% more buses, or we can install home working abilities for people to stay at home on one day in the week. It's absolutely an analog solution. But even if you do not get this 20%, let's take 10%. So the amount of efforts we had to take as a city was much less than to build new roads and new metros. Negative effect is our mayor cannot cut a ribbon. It's much more comfortable for politics to cut a ribbon, push a button, a new solution, and all the problems are solved. But in fact, it was cheaper, and in our eyes, it was a smarter solution than to build a new road and to build another device on the road and to be faster. Stay at home and work from home. Also, a part of the story we try to keep in mind when we fight traffic congestions. And of course, additionally, the topics like economic strengths and livable public spaces, they are in the top agenda of our city planning, of our city policy. And we have to protect people and environment and make mobility following process, progress, make mobility more secure and more smooth and better running. Doing that, of course, we have an ITS strategy, information technology. Traffic controlling information system, intelligent parking, we heard a lot about that. We tried this, what we heard from this parking detection system. Unfortunately, we have a lot of trees. We have a lot of trees, and for good reason, because trees give shadow to the cars and you don't need to sit in your heated car. What did our cameras? We have trees covering all parking lots. We tried this with underground installations, expensive, we heard. So in the end, we have to find another solution. But it's not so easy to install cameras everywhere to detect free parking spaces if you have covered the parking spaces by trees, which is an explicit policy aim to have a greener city. Difficult. And we are still working on that solution wherever we have parking lots which are free of trees. Yes, then we can install this. In wintertime, it's an underground installation, we have snow. And if you have 10, 15 centimeters of snow, you cannot work with optical solutions, we have a radar solution. Or inference solutions, magnetics. Many, many difficulties, and in the end, in some parts we say, forget it. It works as it is. Maybe it's not working 100%, but if it works 70%, it's also fine, instead of installing millions and millions for a solution which brings us just 5% closer to a solution. We have to think about that. In which part of the city we need or we want to have our investments as a city, our limited resources to spend. Of course, real-time data traffic is an issue. Progress provides us with technical means to do so. And the check-in, check 5 seconds to load their container to disappear instead of blocking the road again. This is a question where we have a quite clear defined problem and we solve it with technical means, and we are trying to improve this and reduce the 35 seconds to 25 seconds, which is a huge challenge, to bring a truck exactly on this slot to the container terminal, load and disappear, make space free for the next container. A number of data protection issues is also quite important for us. And, in the beginning, we complained in Germany about our strict data protection laws and regulations, but in the end, we are happy that we find some solutions which might be transferable. If we have detection cameras to detect cars and license places and even the face of the driver, so a lot of courts decided that we are not allowed as a city to detect your face. Maybe you were on a secret trip to wherever, nobody wants to know you, but the government knows that you are in the car. So that's the reason for us. We had to find another way, so we installed thermal cameras. We do not care about the face of the driver and the license plate. We wanted to count the cars. So we had always to adapt new technologies, answering a very limited corridor of data protection use. Is the government the bad guy collecting all data and using this data against the citizens or not? And so we're very careful. We are very careful with data handling, data collection, due to experience. And I think we are on a good way there to find solutions also to solve the counting issue with another technical issue. Smart parking, yeah, we also identified this as an idea to combine and work together with Volkswagen, BMW, Mercedes, a lot of transport companies, to detect the parking lot or whatever, with radar or infrared or magnetic, and to submit the signal at once to the car. Our experience was, which we gained manually, that the average parking space in the city of Hamburg is free for 30 seconds, 35 seconds roughly. So if I leave my home, want to go to the office, and my navigation system says, look there in front of your office, there's a free parking space, until I'm there, it's already not available anymore. So I need another legal system to reserve this car parking space for me, or, well, I have to drive just into the city center and then hope that my navigation system offers me another free parking space. But it's not a question of technology. We learned that it's easy to detect a free parking space, but how to reserve it for me that I can make use of it. And this is a real challenge for us to find, well, a way to fight the congestion, the parking, searching, transport, instead of just install a solution and to spend some millions on it for camera solutions, which is not really a benefit for me. Because I tried this system and my navigation system guides me perfectly on the meter exactly to the parking space, but it's already occupied. Thank you. So we have to work on this and to find a solution which is much better, and I trust that we'll be clever industry partners who will find solutions which we can use later on in the city. What we tried also with other means than technological means was, you see on the left bottom, so we tried to combine. We combined public transport, the mass transport with buses, metros, with a fare system. So if you buy a metro ticket, monthly ticket in an abonnement or wherever, you can also get with the same ticket a shared car or bicycle, a city bike. It was a huge step forward, instead of having three separate ticket systems, just a combined, not technological system, but I think a smart solution to attract people who do not want to have an own car, but I want to be mobile. And where the bus stop is, and I have to go in a rainy day another 2 kilometers to my grandma, I take a rental car. Or if it's just I want to have a bike and then want to get rid of the bike, take the metro with the same ticket. It's a pricing system. And just to combine the several transport means with the same fare system, with the same ticket. So this was an advantage where we can offer not only driving by car comfortable, but be mobile in the city. And be mobile by city, it's just a question of combine the car sharing system, which is IT driven with your smartphone, whatever, the payment system is IT driven, but the rest was legislative driven by organizing a fare system that enables us to be with less transport means on the same mobility rate. Of course, on-demand shuttles, another issue, industrial partners are working quite close. I agree the car on the right top is not really fascinating, but it's practical. And if you look to the commercial spots of Porsche, BMW, this is not really a Porsche, but maybe it works for example of this other company. You will not see a commercial spot from BMW with arguments with ratio. That's emotion pure. And so we try to answer also with emotion. We try to answer with emotion by being mobile, being a city, be a mobile city, be a city which is livable, and be happy in the city and enjoy life in the city, and not only be a rational, functional city, but also a city where you love to live in. Following this, we have some aims which are to adjust, but until the next 10, 15 years, we have to upgrade our infrastructure, and that's a huge investment. That's investment not only in asphalt, but also in IT solutions. And we are starting with test fields. We are testing here and there with some spots where can we generate from this test beds to the whole city. Where are very specific issues. We cannot transfer container transport. It's not an issue for the airport or not for the school transport. But where can we transfer solutions from one sector to the other? And where can we eliminate mistakes or do not pay double for mistakes we made already? Automatic driving is a large issue in Europe, especially in Germany. We have a lot of factories and car producers which are dealing with that, trying to have a good position in the world market. And as we heard, there are only one mistake may happen, one accident may happen, then the whole section is in a bad situation for the next few years, and we are trying to avoid these mistakes. But using electric autonomous vehicles are already in work. The airports have always this autonomous driving metros, and the first step is for us to use metros, but the next step will be our city utilities cleaning vehicles. They can clean the roads in the night autonomous. That's our own ability to install in our car fleet, in our cleaning vehicles, some autonomous devices, and they can work there and drive. And so the rest of the private cars, what is in Volkswagen, it's not really our influence and not really our ability to act, but where we can act is in our own fleet. We discussed it with our fire brigades and police, and they really sent us to hell until we have the first self-driving police car. It will take some 100 years. Our policemen said they are not ready to give the sovereignty of driving a police car following a bad guy by the autonomy by computer. But we will see. Also, fire brigades and emergency vehicles, they still are very reluctant and distant to have autonomous emergency vehicles. They still want to have this human factor on board. And we will see how fast or how far technology will take over. Then, it's an invitation to you all to come and visit Hamburg in a couple of years to the ITS World Congress. We, our minister on the top left, signed there. After the ceremony, and following this, we are quite keen to start a number of projects to demonstrate, and we also get some support from the federal government, which is precious, and we are very happy for that, to demonstrate what is possible, to demonstrate a testbed for autonomous driving in ITS in public spaces. But the administration has to follow and not only focus on the field of public transport or transportation, the daily work, which is just being there in the office as a public office, giving passports or giving building permissions, should be anyhow adapted to modern technology. And so these are the key principles that we do not want to follow, but also want to act proactively. Well, we are a little bit behind sometimes. But the automatic cataster we installed now, just we have a cataster which is, of course, automatically digitalized. But if you want to have a cataster or map of your property, when you go to an office and pay maybe $10 fee, and then you get a digital version or a printed version, whatever. And in the end, if you buy a property, you have to go to a lawyer, and then it has to be done in the normal analog way. So finding legal ways to make it digitalized and to be acceptable for all legal issues, that's a big challenge, how to install technology possibilities into a legal system which is based on analog activities. And this is one of the main challenges for us. We can provide nearly each sector with digital solutions, but it does not work due to some legal restrictions or some analog behavior of people. So how we start with our organization, we started this 2 years ago, and of course, again, public servants make like this the structures. So an ambassador team, factory team, department, we come back to this in a couple of seconds when we see that the program itself, the program organization, the program asked all administrations, where are your digital challenges? In environmental office, in the transportation office, in the social office, in the school ministries, in cultural issues, what are your main urgent problems to be digitalized? Where can we start? Where do we want to have a solution? Where do we want to start the program? We selected some prototypes. Of course, we've got a huge list of things to do. After we started, each office said, we have to work here and there and there, but we cannot do everything at the same time. And prototypes should serve as a reference. So one of these references is, of course, a common database and a common data language. The last 10, 15 years, each of the sectors developed own digital solutions. The environmental offices had their measurements and their solutions how to measure air quality. Huge databases about the air quality in each part of the city, but they use their own system. And the transportation department did the same. But they're not compatible to each other. And then we are facing now the question how to bring all the data together, bring all the data we collected already in an analog way or in a digital way, and not being compatible to each other, bringing together in an urban data platform. And this is one of the keys for us to have an urban data platform where we're hosting the urban data. We have already a huge amount of urban data in the archives since hundreds of years. And also this data are precious for us. We are not talking about future or present data, but also data which were stored 10 years, 20 years ago. What about the old construction plans of a bridge which was 100 years ago erected? We need these plans today. We want to repair this, to calculate what's in the abutments in quite practical issues. What about our sewage system, which was also planned 100 years ago and erected? The old data are there. So digitalizing all the data and find intelligent algorithms to read exactly what is written in all these millions and millions of files and what of this data is usable for us and which data can we use and need for future improvement of our system. That's a huge, huge challenge. And of course we can hire some thousand staff members reading this, but we use technological solutions to update all the data, digitalize them, and try to extract what of the former data or former experience can be used for the future or for the present. So we install an urban data hub, and when we come to the next step, if we will finish this in the next 2-3 years, some sections are already digitalized and usable for the data hub. So the question is, on what level should we work with the data, with the actual data and historical data? Of course, the easiest way is information system. Where is the traffic jam? Where is the truck? Where can we go faster through? Where is actually the school open? Or where are the school buses in real time? That's fine. And that's the most visible part and the first step. Second step, of course, is for us to give decision support systems. What will happen if we close this road for construction work? Where will the transport flow? Where do we have some dangerous parts? When should we allocate a construction site in order to avoid traffic jams or overlapping with school beginning or holidays or whatever? So this is a planning decision support system, which is directly a result of our data platform. In parts it's already working, especially in the transportation or the road construction section, where we now are able to say, if we block a road for construction work, then we can plan it. Should we do it now or in 2 weeks or in 1 month in order to avoid major congestions or have a better transport ability? And of course, the decision system, this is the highest level, the king's discipline, quite at the right, that we try and have the machine decision-making system idea sometimes, that we give all data which are available. And the dream of our heads of office and politicians is, give me the problem, put all data inside, push a button, and then give the optimal solution outside. Very hard to get, and needs a huge amount of data, and sometimes we find that we have more than the optimized solution in a technical way. We have also social issues to cover. How should we steer the intensity of street lighting? When we discussed this, it was quite in the question of the right. A car never needs a street lighting. They have the headlights already, so we make all our street lightings for pedestrians. So makes a movement detection system. Whenever a person moves there, then the light switches on, and as soon as you pass by, the light goes off. Sounds logical, but the next step was when we said, what about the bad guy sitting in the dark, motionless, waiting for you?